Hello, bakers. Welcome to today's episode of The Dough Doctor. I'm your chef, I'm your host and expert baking chef, Chef Colette, and welcome to the show. If you're watching on the replay, thank you for watching. And welcome everyone, nice to see you. It is a hot one here in LA, and more about that as we get to the end of the show. So, bakers, it has been so hot that I suspect not many of you are baking, which is totally normal. And even me, who I pretty much bake every day, I've really slowed down just because of the heat. So put it in the comments. How hot is it where you are right now? Let us know. It is 84 degrees right now in my kitchen. I'm nice and like glowy and shiny, and that is just the way it is. So that's okay. But what we're gonna do for this week, and no questions. So if you have questions, please drop them in the comments below. If you have been baking and something cropped up that you were like, why is this happening? Put it in the comments and we'll get it answered. Normally I have about a dozen questions to pick through, but I think it's just been too hot. So what we're gonna do instead of starting with questions, just drop those questions in as you think of them. They can even just be, how do we bake in this heat? What do we do? I don't know. Whatever is popping into your baker's mind right now. Instead, I'm going to show you how to shape and assemble the heirloom tomato tart. It's the project we're doing with our quick puff pastry that we made last week. And honestly, with the weather being as hot as it is, if you want to make something out of puff pastry, we've got to make it unless you have a good insulated bag, because the dough is going to thaw by the time you get it home. So welcome. I see some of my regulars. Thank you so much for joining me. And I see a question. Great. Wow. Benelli 9231 has a great question. Do I prefer a tilt head mixer or the lift kind? Is one better than the other? No. One is not better than the other, but I have owned both. The tilt head kind can be very good if you're primarily focused on yeasted doughs. It's the most like a commercial mixer, where you lift the bowl up. Now the tilt head kind, we love it because we can really get in there, lift the head up and scrape down. For the past 2 years, I've been only using the tilt head mixer because my one that the bowl lift, I donated to the thrift store down the street because I just had too many mixers. And during the pandemic, I went through a big Marie Kondo type clearing out of my baking equipment. And I really looked at how I was baking in my life and what I needed and I didn't need, and I didn't need three mixers. So one is, to answer, one is not better than the other, but the bowl lift kind is great if you're focused on yeasted doughs because it tends to contain the dough a little bit easier than the tilt lift. The gist of the physics of the tilt lift, that, you know, as the dough is working in the bowl, it likes to creep out. So you have to stop, I mean, not all the way out. I'm so dramatic, you guys, you know how dramatic I am. It lifts up, you know, it'll kind of pop up above the dough hook. And anytime you're making a bread dough and it lifts up above the dough hook, it's not mixing. So you have to stop the mixer and push everything down. That doesn't happen a ton, but it was something that the bowl lift did less. So they're both good. They're both good. Great question. Yes, the air fryer is, I'll be straightforward. I don't have one, but my baking sister, Chef Gina, she has one, and she's always talking about how great it is. I am a society of one. It is just me. So I tend to be super minimal, but I have heard only great things about the air fryer, especially in this heat. And then of course, grilling and anything we can do without turning on the oven. We're gonna turn on the oven today. The oven is actually on, but we're not gonna have it on for too long. So we have a question from Sherry. Some baking recipes call for pectin. What is best? Okay, little bit more detail. What specifically are you making with pectin? What are you making that has pectin in it? Because usually it's always fruit fillings or jams. And basically, I'm stepping out of frame. When I buy pectin, I know it's backwards because it's Instagram. When I buy pectin, I buy Pomona pectin, which I get at Whole Foods, and this is about $5, almost $6 a package. You can order more online for fillings. I really like Pomona Universal pectin. I think it's best. You can also go, I mean, it's the most, it's very mainstream. Ball is a ball pectin, which comes in a liquid form and a powdered form. I mean, they wrote the book on canning and preserving. So that's a great brand. And then also, I know if Chef Daniel is watching, I better mention Modernist Pantry. That's modernistpantry.com. And they have several different types of pectin on their website. But basically, if you're making simple fillings for, I immediately think of like macarons, or you're making a filling for like a really nice, maybe you're doing some, let me know what you're making specifically, what kind of fillings. And then I can answer a little bit more specifically. Yes, absolutely. That's what you're going to use. The same kind of pectin, like this Pomona Universal pectin, that's what you're going to use in your in the fillings. Ah, the oven is preheated. That's good news. All right, Chef Serena is requesting to go live with me, and let's just put a pin in that. And I'm gonna just assemble. We have to do this tart in two stages. So let me just get it in the oven, and then we'll go on and continue the conversation. So bear with me. So I have a tart shell. I can't pick it up because it's too fragile, but I have this, it's about a 9-inch round. And I'll show you how to do this. I made a pretty little rim out of strips of pastry. Now the thing with puff pastry, we've got all those layers. So I'm not expecting it or demanding that it be controlled or pretty. As much as I love controlled or pretty, the pastries we make with puff pastry, for the most part, especially in the savory realm, are rustic. And Our summer baking, right? We're not gonna slave all day making a cake out of the cake Bible in this time of year. So something quick and rustic and delicious that we can put together, that's what we're going for. I dated myself with that reference to the cake Bible. It's probably the best book ever written about cake. So, you know, that's the God's truth. So for my mise en place, I have pesto, and full disclosure, I bought it. And then I had, I found some nice heirloom tomatoes at the market. You might have beautiful tomatoes in your garden. Let us know if you have tomatoes in your garden. That'd be great. It'd be great to use them up. And this is the time of year when, if you are a gardener, You don't need me to tell you it's beginning to explode, right? Can keep a person really busy. So I have partially baked it. So let's just rewind, bakers. So when we make a sweet or savory tart, sometimes we have to partially bake the dough. We went through all that, right? Remember to review. So the bottom layer of pastry underneath the filling isn't soggy. And for using puff pastry as a tart base, we have to do this. So you'll see me, I'll put it together pretty quickly. But pesto's pretty wet and oily, right? So we need at least a partial bake underneath our pesto. Then it's gonna go back in the oven. I'm just gonna stir my pesto up because the oil separated a little bit. And you know, you can make pesto and freeze it, and then you can have it all winter long in the freezer. Some experts do recommend keeping the cheese out and adding it when you go to use the pesto. And so just a layer of pesto, and then just some tomatoes, single layer, or else it'll be too wet. And the other thing that's really important is some salt and pepper. And bakers, please remember this even when you're making something like pizza. One of the reasons pizza, if you go to a really good pizza place and it's super delicious, it's because they're seasoning the pie before it goes in the oven. So I'm gonna turn around and get my salt and pepper. This is the cutest pepper mill on the planet, I think. And I'm just going to sprinkle some salt, and that's just sea salt, and then grind some fresh pepper. Then I have grated Parmesan cheese. I'm kind of light with the salt because Parmesan cheese is salty. And the pesto is seasoned too. But we don't want those tomatoes to be naked and have no seasoning on them. So I'm gonna pop this into the oven. I preheated the oven to 400 degrees, and I was typing up the recipe before the show. 400, put the tart in, and reduce it to 375. Now, I know you're probably all having the vapors, thinking about turning on your ovens to 400 degrees, but just bear with me, it'll be pretty, I promise. And we do that so that when our product goes in the oven, it gets an initial burst of heat. And this can be a really useful technique to do, not for everything, not for delicate bakes, not for bakes that are full of butter and sugar and eggs like cake, but it's really a good technique to use for yeasted doughs. Like a tray of croissants, 400 degrees, and then turn down to 375. Because bakers, when you open that oven door, you can lose 30 to 40 degrees like that, and it can take a while for the thermostat to come to recover. And those initial couple minutes of baking, that's where the magic happens. So if it gets the product, whatever you're baking, like our heirloom tomato tart, gets a good burst of heat, then we're gonna get some good lift, maybe a little bit more lift, and we'll get some beautiful caramelization. But you've gotta remember to turn it down. So very important. All right, any questions? No, okay, good. Let's see if, let me just clean my station here. Before we go on to rolling the dough, can we bring Chef Serena in without my screwing everything up? That would be great. That would be really fun. I bet she has a question. We'll give it a couple minutes and see. All right. So while we're waiting, the next thing we're going to do is we're going to roll out our puff pastry dough, quick puff pastry. I keep saying puff pastry. And that has been in the freezer since last Saturday. I removed it from the freezer Friday night and I put it in the refrigerator and I let it thaw overnight. Now we want to work with it cold, and we've got I've got some bench flour. I've got my rolling pin. And we're going to roll the dough out into a 10 by 10 inch square. And you must be like, but Chef, that tart was round. Bear with me. Again, it's insanely hot. So we're going to work with this cold dough. Cold, 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 but thawed. Can't roll it out if it is, frozen. I was just thinking back to Sherry's question about the pectin. You can also use agar in jellies and fillings. That's another possibility. Anyway, you can put a pin in that. But pectin, the thing with pectin is pectin has to be added to part of the sugar in order for it to activate. It doesn't work as well just to throw everything into the mix. So there's a couple things we need to consider with pectin. Sorry, I digress. I had a crazy professor moment there. The light bulb went on and I just wanted to mention that. All right, back to our tart. So this is a 6 by 6 inch, roughly, maybe more like a 6 by a 5 inch rectangle. And we're gonna gently tap. I'm gonna give it a quarter turn, make sure no stickage. What's stickage? That's when your dough sticks to the work surface. So be careful with that. And once I get it, I stop banging when I get to a half inch. When I get it a half inch thick, and as a matter of fact, bakers, if you get into making this quick puff pastry, and if any of you did, you saw it went together in a New York second. You can actually chill it, roll it into sheets like you would buy it, put parchment paper in between the layers and freeze it that way. And then you don't have to pound it like this. Okay, now I'm gonna begin to roll. And I just naturally give it a quarter turn. I have my yardstick, my DIY pastry rulers right here. And they're gonna go down alongside this pastry and we're gonna start rolling. Remember that a yardstick you get at Home Depot, Lowe's, Menards, anywhere you get your home improvement sort of things, is a standard quarter inch. So if we use the ruler as tracks, then we're automatically at a quarter inch. Now our puff pastry, we roll thin. For finish, we want to be an eighth of an inch, kind of like all that tart dough we were working on earlier in the summer. So quarter inch, and I give it a turn to make sure it's even. Then I take the rulers away, DIY rulers, and then I'm just going to start edge to edge, okay? I'm just going to roll it a little bit thinner. Make sure to roll with nice even pressure, starting at the base and going all the way to the top. That's where we have our best leverage. Okay. All right. This is about this is about a 10 by 10 inch square. And I also have a 9 inch cake round. All right. You just need, if you want, and you could make this tart square. As a matter of fact, we could do that. Or actually, that one's round. Let's make this one round. So this will give us a guide. This will give us a guide. We're not going to use this yet, though. So you notice I kind of had a free-form rim. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to cut strips of dough off the edge. I don't want to get too carried away. And they're about 3/4 inch thick. And they don't have to be cut from the side. I'll cut one from the bottom. And I can use my ruler to get a nice straight edge. Oh, by the way, so this, the DIY ruler, this is 1/4 inch, and this is usually, it's usually an inch wide. Anyway, just, I mean, and they're always under $1, and they're just so useful. Okay, so one more strip of dough off the top, and this is gonna make my edges. Works pretty well. There we go. Then I'm going to use this cardboard and I'm going to just cut, I'm going to cut around just like that. Get this out of the way. Any scraps that you want to use, do not ball up. Just get them in the fridge immediately before they melt. You could cut those into little circles, dust them with cinnamon sugar, and they'd be a really lovely little snack. You know, maybe you have little ones or big folks who would love a sweet little snack like that of puff pastry. Then we're gonna move this to our baking tray. You guys can see that, and it looks good. Now, the next thing I'm gonna do is I'm gonna take a fork and I'm going to dock it. Because, and as a matter of fact, so that you can see it better, I'm gonna do this on the back of the tray. I can kind of give you a little bit more. Yeah, that's good. Okay, so the reason we dock it, like we dock some of our other tart doughs, and is so that it doesn't rise up. Now, especially something that's this is like a partial lamination. We gave this 4 book folds. The docking is very, very important. So I'm gonna be lots of holes and I'm gonna go all the way to the edge. And we do this before the rim goes on. And I'm docking all the way to the edge. It's like an escape valve for the steam that's created in the layers. And then I'm gonna take a little water and my teeny tiny pastry brush. Brush the edge with water. And you can get fancy. If you want, you could twist your edge, which is kind of pretty. And you can twist it as you apply it to the edge of the tart. You don't want to overhandle it though, because remember, it's weird, you know, it's just really, really warm. And you might not use, or just put it on flat, doesn't matter. Okay. And then where you have to join a strip, that's okay. Just kind of attach them to each other. So bakers, put it in the chat. Are you guys baking at all or is it just too hot? I really appreciate you being with me today. You could have not signed in. You could have said, oh, chef, you are nuts. I am not doing this. But then we wouldn't have had the great question about pectin. That was a great question. Thank you, Sherry. Okay, so now it's going to go into the refrigerator. And the way I wrote the instructions in the recipe, which will be live on the website at bakingwithcolette.com, probably tomorrow because I'm ahead of schedule, I said chill the tart while the oven is preheating. So about 15 minutes. And then these, I got extra strips, and they're gonna go back in my plastic wrap. And I'll use these for something. You can get 2 to 3 rolls out of this puff pastry. The more you roll it, the less it's going to lift. But little, cinnamon sugar cookies or little cheese straws, they would be acceptable with this. Except they would be acceptable. Oh, bakers, I sound like I work at the Ritz still. All right. Let's see what our tart looks like. Pretty good. I'm going to give it a few more minutes, just like 3 more minutes. It is not, what's great is with that little bit of a chill, it's not bleeding butter out the bottom. So 2 more minutes on that, and I'll take any questions that are coming in, make the announcements for what's coming up next. And then we'll have our reveal of our heirloom tomato tart. So, what would happen is, let's recap. I rolled the dough out into a 10 by 10 inch approximate rectangle. I cut strips about 3/4 of an inch wide off the various sides, and then I used a cardboard cake round for as a template. Now, I'm not going to throw this out. I actually have a small collection of these in the freezer because I'm not going to put this back in the box with grease on it, but if I stick them in the freezer off to the side alongside the wall, there isn't going to be any bacterial growth, and I can use this for my next layer cake. So we're always trying to think about being as sustainable as possible, and that's one way you can do it. All right. And then I put the round on a baking tray, docked everything with my fork, created my edges, chilled that, preheat the oven. Then we will start where I started the show, where I assembled it, and then it's ready to go into the oven. All right. So that was the recap on the heirloom tomato tart. The quick puff pastry can be used for turnovers. It can be used for tarts. It can be used for cheese straws. Put it in the comments if you've ever had a puff pastry cheese straw. I mean, they are worth every calorie. So good. And I think in my time as a line cook, prep cook, and banquet chef, I've probably formed thousands of cheese straws. But we didn't make the puff pastry. It came in boxes and just making so many. And then, of course, teaching as well. So, anyway, cheese straws are super yummy, and you can use this quick puff pastry for them. I bet it'll be one you'll pull back and you'll hearken back to in the fall because when it cools down and we really get our groove back. And we start seriously baking again. All right, I'm gonna pull this out of the oven. It's really, really quite beautiful. Really, really pretty. And it would be lovely with a little bit of basil, garnished with a little bit of fresh basil on the top. Now, here's one last tip I'm going to leave you with. Since I mentioned basil, when you're baking, and we're talking about savory baking, so we're thinking like pizza, we're thinking tarts, we're thinking savory turnovers. So like the sky's the limit, right? Well, when we're working with fresh basil, we want to put it on the product after it comes out of the oven. If you put it on and bake fresh basil, it actually becomes the texture of like tobacco leaves with a faint basil flavor. So we always want to do that after the fact. We already have the pesto for great basil flavor, but if you want to do a pretty garnish after it comes out of the oven, you can, you know, if you have chopped your basil, you can put it on top, or if you have a couple beautiful leaves, small leaves of basil, you can garnish with that. All right. Well, you guys, that's just about it for this hot show, this hot midsummer. Our tart is hot coming out of the oven, and we found a great way to quickly and easily use our quick puff pastry from last week. You could cut that tart into small wedges and serve it as an appetizer the next time you have a party, or, you know, like a barbecue. It's a great starter. Maybe a pitcher of sangria or some lovely, really cold wine or sparkling water. Like, absolutely perfect. And it's a great way to showcase tomatoes from your garden, tomatoes from the farmer's market, and maybe you're deep into making your homemade pesto for the year, so you can show that off as well. I have an announcement about the show. It is going to be searingly hot the entire month of August. We have no doubt, right, bakers? So the Dough Doctor is going to go dark until after Labor Day. Then we're going to come back in full force. I'm going to use August to regroup and maybe try to find a larger platform for the show, but I will have plenty of notifications on Instagram so that you all know what's happening, all right? And then also, please check in with me from time to time. I'll be posting some fun stuff like the creme brulee cupcakes from yesterday. I don't know if you saw those, but they were unbelievably delicious. Really, really great. So that's my plan for the show. And I know I've been teasing a new cookbook. I already have the macaron book, and I'm gonna try to regroup on that as well and get started. And so we'll be back this Saturday after Labor Day. Keep in touch. If you have any questions, you know where I am, and I will keep a vigilant eye on my DMs and any messages on anything I post, and I'll get right back to you. Bakers, I love you. Thank you so much for your support, and I will keep you posted on when the Dough Doctor will be live again. Thank you so much. Happy baking. Stay cool and have a wonderful day. Bye.